Open source projects that hire. I've made a lot of open source contribution videos, but from now on, for the next 7 to 8 months, we will not be contributing to Google Summer of Code projects. We will be contributing to projects that are good businesses that have open sourced either completely their code base or a certain part of their code base. They are companies that have raised at least $5 to $10 million, have at least 5, 10, 15 employees in their company, are actively contributing, actively hiring, and are good businesses. This way, there's a path for you to get hired into these companies by making open source contributions. The code base is out there, the issues are out there, get them assigned to you and start solving. In this video, we're doing one such organization. The organization is called cal.com. They've raised more than $30 million, are a real business that I've used in the past for my calendar scheduling. And hence, you know, there's a path to getting hired there. There are good employees there. And if someone starts contributing to the project actively and does well, there is a path for them to get hired. I'm not sure if they actually will hire you, but there's definitely a path. In this series, we'll be contributing to such projects, picking them up from scratch, setting them up locally, picking up issues that are out there, solving them, creating a pull request. And by the end of it, you should be equipped to at least understand the code base and start contributing. After that, all that matters is how much hard work you put in and of course, how good you are at your job, how good you are at solving issues. Cool. I started contributing to this project yesterday. I was able to set up the code locally and I was able to solve one issue. In this video, I'll be showing you what this project does, how to set it up locally, how I solved my first issue yesterday that got merged. And today we'll be picking up a random issue from their good first bugs and solving one live. So that part might be a little longer because I'll be figuring things out as we go. But hopefully through this process, you should be able to understand the code base of cal.com. And if you want to start contributing, you can do that as well. A few disclaimers. One, I don't work directly with cal.com. This video is not sponsored and I'm not sure whether or not they're hiring actively. So don't keep that as a motivation. They may be hiring, they may not be hiring. I don't know. Two, please don't spam the project. A lot of times when I've made these videos, I've seen people sort of create a lot of pull requests that are not yet issues. They sort of create issues in their head and start solving things. Try not to do that. It gets very overwhelming for maintainers if there are so many pull requests out there. If you want to contribute, I have created a fork where you can test your contributions. Only actually contribute to the project if you're very sure it actually solves the issue. If you've actually tested the issue locally, don't make file changes without setting up the project and create a pull request, else there'll be like a lot of pull requests for the maintainers and we don't want to make their life miserable just because they've made their project open source. Their life actually must be made much easier. So keep that in mind. If you're still practicing, still learning, contribute as much as you can, but to the fork that I've created, don't contribute directly to the project. If you're really good, if you know you've actually solved an issue, then of course, feel free to contribute. With that, let's get right into the video. So what is cal.com? If you've heard of Calendly, it's pretty much very similar. There's an interface like this where you can create a calendar-like interface where people can come and schedule calls with you. So if I quickly claim this username and maybe sign up, then you see an interface like this and I have a few meetings that I can share the links for to my friends. And when they open those links, they can basically see my calendar and schedule a meeting with me, a 15-minute slot, a 30-minute slot, so on and so forth. Very similar to Calendly if you've seen that project. Now, what is the tech stack? The tech stack, from what I could understand, is all in Node.js and JavaScript, actually more specifically TypeScript. The front end is Next, if I'm not wrong. They have Storybook integration as well, so the components can be very well written there. I think the backend does not use an HTTP server. It uses something called as TRPC. I've heard of this. I haven't used this, but this is a beautiful technology. If you've gone through assignment 1 and 2, you now understand how to create like backend servers. This is a more complicated way to create a backend server. And the good thing, or the reason this is used, is because it provides very strong types on both the front end and the back end. Quickly, to understand what that means, if you see here, if I make a change, this is the backend code on the left, this is the front end code on the right. This is not cal.com, this is the TRPC project. And if you make like a change here in the backend, and if you don't make the same change in the front end, let's say you changed the type, you changed message to name, like the expected input now from your backend is name, you will have to make that change in the front end as well, else it'll throw an error. So that's sort of the use case of TRPC. It gives you very nice types on both front end and back end. And I think that's what they're using for their back end. And front end, as I said, is in Next.js. In our second assignment, we learned about React.js. Next.js is sort of similar. And I think you can reuse a lot of knowledge here and slowly start understanding Next.js. Cool. That's the project. Now let's clone the project and let me show you the issue that I solved yesterday. The way to clone a project, as all of you might know, is copy the link here. Make sure you have Git installed and then simply do a git clone project name. This might take a few minutes because this is a very big repository. I've already done that, so I already have cal.com here in my local machine. Now let's open it up in an IDE and start to explore it. So I just open it up in WebStorm, and here, as you can see, there are a few folders on the left. We can actually explore them on GitHub. We can ignore all of these for now. The important ones are packages. This is like a very common way to structure packages in a full stack application, both front end and back end. So this contains like a bunch of small packages that are used throughout your app. It has an apps section, which are like the final end user apps, which basically use these packages to render these or like create the website, create the storybook plugin, so on and so forth. So there's like a storybook module that'll show you all the components. There's like a Swagger module that'll let you hit all HTTP endpoints. There is a web component, which I'm assuming is the Next.js project. So to understand this a little better, most full stack projects have two very nice top level directories, apps and packages. Packages are where you write very small modules that your apps use. A bunch of times packages use each other as well, but apps are the final end user product, for example, in this case, the cal.com website, which the end user uses. That's the final Next.js application or your final HTTP server or your storybook create that people can sort of look at your components on. But they all under the hood, they all want to like reuse a bunch of these things. Like you want to reuse components between your storybook and your Next.js project. So you want to sort of encapsulate all of that into packages. That's why you have this packages directory in like most full stack projects. It might be named differently, but these are the two important folders that you need to look at: apps and packages. If we go deeper into this, there's like a day.js folder here, which I'm assuming contains all the time zone specific things, which is very important for a project like this because everyone is in a different time zone when scheduling. Email probably contains all the logics to write emails, send emails, things like this. So that's a brief of what packages does and what apps do. We won't dive deeper into this yet. We will solve a few issues and then slowly get comfortable with the code base. So let's look at the issue that I solved yesterday. If you look at the issue, it says, issue summary, using the Discord app, the URL validation doesn't allow Discord links that are not discord.gg. For example, discord.com/channels... does not work. What does this mean? This means that when you're on cal.com and you're trying to create a new meeting, you can actually give like a meeting link. Where do you want this meeting to open up? So if I create a new meeting one here, and I set a duration and everything, it'll basically ask me where this should happen. Right now, what is selected is cal video, but you can also select something like Discord here. To be able to do that, you have to first install the Discord application in your Calendly. So if I search for Discord and if I click on install here, it should install. So this is like a very nice thing they've done. Like they've basically allowed anyone, Google Meet, Zoom, to integrate directly with cal.com, and then people can use those meeting links when they're scheduling their meetings. So here I just added Discord, and now if I go to any of my meetings, I can just edit them and try to change the location to Discord. And when I do that, or when I used to do that up until yesterday, I couldn't write discord.com here. If I try to update discord.com, well, it still says, because like my change hasn't yet been deployed to production, my change has been merged but not yet deployed on cal.com. So it still says invalid URL for Discord, sample URL like this, which means you have to have discord.gg in the URL. Only then will it allow you to update it, else it'll start complaining. But now Discord lets you create invitation links or meeting links with discord.com as well. And hence we need to make that fix. We need to make sure that this input box allows both discord.com and discord.gg. So the fix was fairly straightforward, but I had to make sure it actually worked, which meant I had to set up the project locally. So what I did now, I cloned the project and then went through the README to understand how I can set up the project locally. So let me close this and this. The steps that are given here are, first clone the project that I've done, then go to the project that I've done, then install the packages with yarn. So let's call yarn in the terminal here and let it run. I think it'll take a few minutes. Okay, so that's done. How do I know that's done? Well, the command succeeded. And also if I go to the node modules folder now, probably see some dependencies there. So like all the dependencies have been installed. Now it says duplicate .env.example to .env. So copy .env.example to .env. Then use this command to generate a secret and add it to this secret in the .env file. So let's do that. Make sure you have OpenSSL installed. If you don't, this command won't run. I got the secret. Let me put this in the .env file. And then it says create another secret and put it here. Okie dokie. And in any project, any good project that will be out there, you'll see there's like a .env.example file that you can just copy over to .env and then put all your environment variables there. These are like secrets or things that you don't want committed directly in your repository and are different for different people. For example, the database URL. When I'm testing this locally, I am connecting to my own database. I don't want to connect to their production database. I don't even have access to their production database. So these are things that you put in the .env file. If you try to explore the .env file, you'll see probably a database variable here. Postgres, there you go. So things like these configurables that you don't want committed, that are different for every contributor, are usually put in a top level .env file. So that's pretty clean. The next thing they say is run yarn dx. This is super helpful, amazing. So what happens is, most projects have front-end, back-end, database, a bunch of things. And if you want to run those locally, you basically have to open 10 terminals and start 10 processes, one for the front-end, one for the back-end, one for the database. But what they've done is they've containerized all of this, dockerized all of this. And they've said, simply run this one command and we'll bring up the database for you, we'll bring up the front-end for you, we'll bring up the back-end, we'll compile everything. One command is all you need. Now, when you're going deeper into this project, you might need to run these individually. But this is super cool, I think. This is like a very nice thing to do in an open source project so that when new people come, they can at least get started by running a single command. So that's great. We will wait for this command to run. Okay. And as soon as it succeeds, make sure you have Docker installed. Also make sure Docker is running locally, else of course this will fail because a lot of this is running inside Docker containers. Let's try to open the link that it gave us, localhost:3000. If I go here, we finally see, we see the website locally. If I go to localhost:3000/auth/login, I see this, which is great. Now, again, when you're doing this in a new project, you have to create dummy users. You have to sign up. A lot of times when you're signing up, the email actually doesn't go out because you don't have the right secrets for the email service. But what cal.com has done, which is very good, I think, is it logs a bunch of users here when you're using the yarn dx command. So if I look through the logs, I can see a bunch of users. Let me copy a temporary user, paste it here. Copy the password, paste it here, sign in, and I should be good to go. So this is a very nice local setup, makes the lives of new developers very easy. I've worked on a bunch of open source projects. This was the smoothest, at least when trying to bootstrap this locally. So big kudos to the team, whoever wrote this logic. The developer experience while setting up this project is great. Cool. Now getting back to the issue. The issue was we need to make sure Discord validation works. So what happened at this point was I knew I need to somehow create a new meeting and then try to add Discord as a link there. So I created a new meeting, call it AST, continue. As soon as this was created, I saw this location section here, which I saw here as well, edit location. So I knew this is where I need to put the Discord link, but I couldn't really figure out how to reach the Discord link because like there's no Discord link here. And then luckily my sort of reached the apps section and I realized Discord might be an app, and that's totally the case. So if you go here, search for Discord. Again, I did this in the production environment. I haven't yet done it here. So let me do this locally. App successfully installed. And now if I go to my events and try to edit the event and select Discord here and put in a link that looks like discord.com. It is letting me do that now because my fix is already merged in. But if I go back in history and remove my fix that was merged in yesterday, it should stop working most probably. So let's go back in history one commit before my fix. Git reset hard. Hopefully this hot reload seems like it does. If I refresh this now and I select Discord here and I type in a discord.com URL and try to click update, it says you cannot update because the sample URL should look like this, which is the original issue. It should support discord.com. So now comes the final thing of how I actually fixed it. The first thing I did, I searched through the project for discord.gg because I knew there is like some validation happening somewhere. I came here, I realized this is the regex that's checking this URL, whether or not it is right. For those of you who don't know what regex is, it's basically a way for you to pattern match strings to make sure they follow a certain pattern. It's like a very popular thing used throughout the industry. And this is effectively what the validation does. What I did from here was I went to ChatGPT and I told them, hey, could you explain the following regex? So now it pretty much explained what the regex looks like to me, and I can already see it's basically, it should start with HTTPS, it may or may not have www, and then finally discord.gg is the important thing, where like it makes sure that the URL should contain discord.gg. So we need to make the change here. I could simply make it discord.com here, but then the downside there is discord.gg will stop working. We want both of them to work, and the solution there, you can pretty much ask this to ChatGPT as well. I did as well, but like the solution it gave me was much more complicated. The simple fix was something like this. So this should be good to go. It now says that as long as the URL contains both discord.gg and discord.com and has www before it, has HTTPS before it, so on and so forth. The idea is this was a one-line fix. And if you look at my final pull request as well, that's sort of the fix I made here. I replaced discord.com with added brackets and then added or discord.com. So that was the fix. And then the next thing to do was, after I've added this change, make sure it actually works. So click on update now and it does update. As you can see, it hot reloads very quickly. I just made the change here and it automatically propagated to localhost:3000. If I remove the change, save it and just refresh. I don't even have to refresh. It seems like it auto like hot reloads. Go to Discord. And if I type in this, it won't let me. If I change it to the right thing, click on save. Update, it does let me. So it's like very nice hot reloading here. And by the end of it, I was able to fix this. What were the next steps? Well, after you've made the fix, you have to check out a new branch. Make sure your diff is right. Looks decent. Add the diff, commit it, and then push it. So you have to do a bunch of other things, like make sure you fork the repo correctly, which I did. Click on fork here. After you fork the repo, you'll have a fork of the repo locally in your GitHub context. Then make sure you're pushing to this fork. So git remote add origin to this fork, and then git push origin to, and then the name of the branch, which is this, should push this change to your fork, not to the main project. And then from there, you just have to create a new pull request. If I refresh this, it sort of gives me the way to create a pull request. I won't, because while I've already made this fix, the PR was already in. But let's look at the pull request that I made, just to like understand sort of the etiquette that's good to follow when you're creating a pull request. I said fixes this. This is good to write at the very top, so people have context what issue it's fixing. And the other important thing here is, if you mention fixes issue number or closes issue number, when this gets merged, the issue will automatically get closed. So that's like a very nice fancy thing you can do. Environment production, the type of change, bug fix, how do you know this is tested? I posted a screenshot here. Oh god, 4 hearts, I love it. So yeah, everyone got approved yesterday and then finally merged. So these were the steps to follow when making a nice open source contribution, setting it up locally as well, making sure it works as well, no shortcuts. Like this change actually can be done with a bunch of shortcuts. You just search for discord.com, fix the regex and push it in. But always nice to set it up locally, because like how long ahead will you go without actually setting up the project locally? Eventually you need to pick up big things, only then you'll get hired. So make sure you're setting up the project locally. That's step one. Don't blindly start solving issues, because well, if you want to actually convert and get hired, you need to set up the project locally and understand deeper issues, solve deeper issues, and only then you'll be able to sort of get in and get hired. Hi everyone, sorry for the abrupt ending. Let's do part 2 in another video, because this is a very long video in itself and I have to rush somewhere now, where you'll probably know in the next video. But after this, let's do a bunch of educational videos and then dive back into open source contributions. The first one being me contributing to this live again. So look forward to that one. And yeah, that's it for this video. I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.